Hello, and welcome all to the supplementary session of Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation course. In this session, we will be discussing about the concepts of pedigree analysis with few more examples, and we'll try to understand that how to decipher conclusively the mode of inheritance in clinical as well as research settings. Now, let's get started. Just to revise, a pedigree is a family tree or chart made of symbols and lines that represent person's genetic family history. It also helps in determination of mode of inheritance. For example, square here represents male, circle represents female, and so on. Now, human beings contain 22 pairs of autosomes and one pair of sex chromosomes. Females have 22 pairs of autosomes plus XX, whereas males have 22 pairs of autosomes plus XY chromosomes. Now, there can be three kinds of inferences that can be obtained from pedigree analysis. First is the mode of inheritance, second is the genotype of individuals, and third, the probability of children being affected. Now, the latter two inferences are based on the mode of inheritance. So let's discuss about deciphering the mode of inheritance in more detail. Now, the power of evidence and logic is what makes the study of genetics a lot more interesting. So let's go by the logical way of deciphering the mode of inheritance. If you observe a pedigree in which the trait is transmitted by either sex and both males and females are equally affected, then it is most likely to be an autosomal trait. Now, if the trait seems to skip generations, then it is an autosomal recessive trait. Otherwise, it's an autosomal dominant trait. In case of sex-linked inheritance, if you observe always there is father to son transmission, then there are high chances that the trait is Y-linked. Now, Y-linked traits are those traits that are controlled by Y chromosomes and are always get transmitted from fathers to their sons. Now, in case of X-linked traits, all the affected daughters are there of affected father, and the trait does not skip generations, then that means it's an X-linked dominant trait. In other case, if you find in a pedigree that the males are more affected and the trait skips generation, then it is more likely to be an X-linked recessive trait. Now, there is another kind of inheritance known as mitochondrial inheritance, in which the transmission of traits always occur from mother to all the sons as well as the daughters. This is because all the children always carry or inherit the mitochondria from their mothers. Now let's see in this example, that is pedigree example one, if we follow our logical flow chart, then we first will check that if a trait is transmitted by either sex and if males and females are equally affected. So that is indeed the case in our pedigree, because we can see that the trait is can be transmitted by female here and the male here, and we can see that both males as well as females are equally affected. Then that means it's an autosomal trait. Now, in our case also, the trait is not skipping any generations. That means you can see the affected individuals in all of the generations. So this means that our trait in question is autosomal dominant trait. If we try to mark the genotypes of these individuals in the autosomal dominant inheritance pedigree, then we can denote capital A small a genotype to the affected individual. Here, capital A is the dominant allele which is defective and is causing the phenotype. So likewise, all the affected individuals in the family will carry at least one dominant allele. On the other hand, all the unaffected members of the family would carry small a genotype, because to become affected, you need at least one dominant allele. Now, one can observe that the same pedigree can also be explained by autosomal recessive inheritance if we denote small a genotype to all the affected members of the family and capital A small a genotype to all the unaffected members of the family. Now, in this case, both the answers are correct for this particular pedigree, autosomal dominant as well as autosomal recessive inheritance. But in a real life scenario, whenever we encounter problems like this, we need to first rule out the first obvious mode of inheritance. In this case, the obvious mode of inheritance is autosomal dominant inheritance, because as we have already seen, the trait is not skipping the generations, because you see affected individuals in all the generations. So once you rule out the obvious reason or the obvious mode of inheritance, then only you go on to explain the family scenario or the pedigree scenario in the light of other mode of inheritance. Now, in the parallel example, here we see a family which is one of the first few families to be reported with Huntington's disease. Now, in this case, if we follow the logical flowchart, what we see is the trait that we see is transmitted by both the sexes, that is female and male, and both males and females are seen to be equally affected. Therefore, we can say that the trait is autosomal in nature, and also we don't see any skipping of generation. That means the trait is showing autosomal dominant inheritance. Now, you can try and look for other modes of inheritance to explain this particular pedigree. I'm sure you will not be able to do it. Then why is it so? Why, unlike the previous case, why it can be only explained by only autosomal dominant inheritance? What is the difference between this pedigree and the earlier pedigree? The major difference or the striking difference is that this pedigree has multiple generations and a lot more generations than the previous pedigree. And other than that, the pedigree contains a large number of individuals. In the earlier example, there were about 18 individuals, and here you see 40 individuals. So these two features alone gives you the confidence to conclusively decipher the actual mode of inheritance. Now, let's see another example, that is pedigree example 2. In this pedigree, if we again apply our logical flowchart, then we don't see that the trait here is transmitted by both mother and father, and also we don't see that males and females are equally affected. So that means the trait here that we are looking at is sex-linked. And also, if we see this feature, that is father-to-son transmission, we don't observe that. That means the trait here is X-linked. And we see males are more affected, and also the trait is skipping generations as it is not present in the first generation. So this makes us conclude that the trait is X-linked recessive. Indeed, if we denote the genotypes, we can see that the trait can behave in a sex-linked recessive as a sex-linked recessive inheritance. Now, again, similar to the previous case, one can argue that the pedigree can also be explained by autosomal recessive inheritance. And again, we can only say here that we should first find a way to rule out the obvious sex-linked recessive inheritance first. Now, looking at a parallel example of the same kind of inheritance, this is a very famous pedigree of a royal European family of Queen Victoria, in which hemophilia is inherited across multiple generations. Here, through the logical flowchart, we can observe that the trait is not transmitted by either sex, and we don't see males and females being equally affected. Therefore, the trait is sex-linked. And there is no father to son transmission that we can see here. That means the trait is X-linked here. And also we see males are more affected and trait is skipping generations. Therefore, this is a pedigree that shows X-linked recessive inheritance. Now, from the previous two examples, what is the take-home message? Take-home message is that the robustness in identifying the mode of inheritance increases when the pedigree that you are dealing with is multi-generational, that is, it has multiple generations, and the pedigree includes more family members and is thus large enough to conclusively say that what is a mode of inheritance. And in some cases, it is not possible that to obtain a large pedigree or multi-generational pedigree, then in those cases, one can study multiple families carrying the same phenotype and then observe the pattern. Now, in case of novel phenotypes, more evidence, that is, in terms of members of the pedigree or multiple families, should be collected in order to decipher the mode of inheritance conclusively. Now, let's look at a few more examples to understand different modes of inheritance. The first example is of Lone disease, that is, Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy. In this case, one can clearly observe that all the children of an affected mother are affected. Likewise, an affected female is transmitting the trait to all her children. But on the other hand, an affected father is not able to transmit the trait to the next generation. This is a typical example of mitochondrial inheritance. Next, let's look at the non-syndromic hearing impairment trait. Here in this family, you can very clearly see that almost all the affected members are males. And one can clearly observe father to son transmission. This is a typical example of a Y-linked inheritance trait. Next, in case of vitamin D resistant rickets, here we see that all of the daughters of an affected father are affected. And we see unequal distribution of males and females being affected. That means the trait is sex-linked. And since all of the daughters of an affected father are affected and the trait does not skip generations, this is a typical example of X-linked dominant trait. Now, biology is full of exceptions. Until now, we have learned about the general rules of deciphering the mode of inheritance. Let's now look at the few of the exceptions. We have seen that dominant traits never skip generation, but this is not the case. A dominant trait may also skip generation if the variation arises de novo. That means the variation was not present in either of the parents and suddenly appears in one of the children. This happens when the variation is introduced in the gamete just before fertilization or during embryogenesis. Next, a dominant trait can skip generation if the penetrance is not 100%. So this is a very well characterized feature in case of inherited cardiac disorders such as cardiac channelopathies and cardiomyopathies, in which even if one of the parent carries the defective allele, he or she may not be affected, but the child carrying the same allele will be affected. Next, in case of mitochondrial disorders, affected mother may not always transmit the traits to all the children in case of variable expressivity. For example, we see here that in the second generation, all the children of an affected mother are affected. But in the third generation, this is not the case because of variable expressivity. In case of mitochondrial disorders, variable expressivity arises due to heteroplasmy. One single cell contains several mitochondria. Now, if all of the mitochondria are of the normal type, then we say it is homoplasmy. And if there are few mitochondria that carry the variation, then we say that there is low level of variation and the offspring can be mildly affected or even unaffected, as in the case of 3-2 and 3-4 individuals. Or if there are greater number of mitochondria carrying variations, then we say that there is high level of variation and there is a chance that the offspring will be affected. Through this session, I hope that your concepts of pedigree analysis would become more clear, and thank you for paying the attention.